Good evening and welcome to this forum on the future of voting sponsored by the White Bear Lake Area League of Women Voters. My name is Liz Nordling and I will be the moderator this evening. I am pleased to welcome our Secretary of State, Mark Ritchie. Mark was first elected Minnesota Secretary of State in November of 2006. And previous to that, he served as the president of the Institute for Agriculture and Trade Policy from 1988 to 2006. He also founded the League of Rural Voters. A graduate of Iowa State University and the University of Minnesota's Humphrey School of Public Affairs, in 2011, he received the Dwight David Eisenhower Excellence in Public Service Award. I'm pleased to welcome Secretary of State Ritchie. Now, I have submitted questions in advance to Secretary Ritchie, and I hope you're ready. We have lots of them. And the first one is going to be on Electronic Roster Task Force. We know that you are the co-chair of the Electronic Roster Task Force that was created by the 2013 legislature to research several issues, including the following: electronic roster technology, the ability to use photographs received from the Department of Vehicle Services, data security and electronic rosters in the statewide voter registration system, and the ability of precincts across the state to connect to an electronic roster to a secure network to access the statewide voter registration system. And we understand that the task force must submit a report summarizing its findings and listing recommendations on the implementation of electronic rosters by January 31st of this year. So the first question is, could you summarize the findings and recommendations on the implementation of electronic rosters that the task force will include in its report to the 2014 legislature?
Well, there's about 24 hours of testimony, so the answer to your question is no. But I can give you a little bit of information about electronic poll books, and I think this is probably of some heightened interest just because for all of us, we're confronted with the contradictions of the advantages that our electronic devices can provide and the dangers, whether those are hacking or loss or just frustration or whatever. So many of you have been poll workers, or most of you, I assume, have voted, and you know more or less our process. We use paper ballots. We also have paper registers where you sign. This was one of the many systems we use as part of our backup system, but also part of our integrity system. Some states have introduced electronic rosters, and some states who've done that have found that there are savings in time meaning money for local officials. Typically this is at the county level, but because you have the ability to upload the information that comes from signing in, or, and this is actually the biggest cost savings, is in the area of same day registration. Minnesota, in a big year, let's say in a presidential year, about 600,000 of us will register on election day. That means that after election day, our local election officials have a tremendous job, and since so many people scribble on their paper voter registration forms, there's the additional work, not just the 600,000 that must be typed, but the interpretation of handwriting and then the mistakes that are made, many things. So there are some benefits that have been documented in other states. And in Minnesota, one community, Minnetonka, has been testing some systems that are more electronic. And in this last year, in addition to this task force, there also was mandated a test in some polling places of some electronic polling equipment. I think 6 or 7 vendors, something like that. So we have the benefit of both 20 some hours of testimony and discussion and some pilot projects in the polling places. And in a way, both of those reports will come at the same time. And they will lead us into, I believe, a next trial where for some communities that have high numbers of same-day voter registrations, where the cost of really entering that data and getting that data right has gotten very large, we believe that there are some savings, and they're going to test and do a test in a way that we can compare apples to apples to see if that's true. So I feel like we're taking baby steps. Other states around us, some have adopted this, but they're not same-day registration states. For example, North Dakota doesn't have voter registration. It's not something they use in their system. They have a different system, actually an excellent system. So we are taking a slow but sure step towards getting more information, and I think that's an appropriate thing. It'll be up to the legislature to make some of these decisions, but you'll see those recommendations, as you mentioned, on the 31st.
So besides helping with same-day registration, what are the other advantages of electronic rosters over the paper roster that we currently use?
It can be less expensive, but in some instances it can be more expensive. So it's situational more than it's a sweeping thing. I think this is true for all technologies. Some technology can't be assumed good for everyone. But other technology, it depends on the circumstance. About half of our polling places in the state are townships. Some townships don't have electricity. They might have 12 voters. They're already mandated and required to have certain machinery, very expensive. So I'd say it's not possible to just be sweeping. But let me give you a little insight into one of the advantages that we see in general about some of the technology, and that's that when there is a more accurate way to make sure that a name is properly spelled and the address is properly updated, we call that a clean record, then you have the capacity to use electronic lists to help keep your list clean. I experience something that perhaps some of you have, but I'm a candidate for office and I call up people, and sometimes it's delegates, and you have this experience if you've been running for office or just calling, which is you ask for Betty and you hear a pause and you kind of know what's coming, which is that my wife died 2 years ago, will you please take her name off your list? And this might have occurred because the name was Betty or Elizabeth, but when you get the information about a death and a death record, and it's a little complicated, you have to have clean lists to be able to get information and have that happen. I also have the experience of people calling me up, and my daughter's been dead for over 10 years, and they ask for her because her name is still on a list, because somewhere the system does not take her name off the list. So I experienced this myself and I hate it. So one of the advantages of electronic voter registration, electronic polling, is a clean list. And that clean list, it might be just as much protecting our hearts, perhaps, avoiding awkward or upsetting situations, but also you want a clean list. Even if you're a candidate, you don't want extra people's names. You don't want to spend the money for the doorknob. So there are arguments and good reasons for clean list. Can electronics and digital help us get the clean list? Yes, I think so in some instances. So what's the cost-benefit analysis and where does it really start to make sense? I tend to think that broken hearts, you can't put a dollar on that. That's something to really think about. So what can we do?
How are rosters currently kept updated?
Well, so there's a 9-step process before somebody goes on the roster, and then updating it has some other steps, but updating in almost all, but with one exception, take place at the county level. So let me just say that when somebody does register, there's a series of steps that it must go through. You know, we depend on electronic databases or information from Department of Vehicle Services. That's kind of a first check to see if somebody is in that system, and if they're part of that system, does that driver's license match up? If there isn't a driver's license, Department of Vehicle Services uses the Social Security, typically the office in Washington, to see if that last four lines up. And if there's a problem with that, then there's a system that works. But if those things match, then we begin to compare data with the Department of Health, whose maintenance of the death registry within our state is supplemental with what we used to call the National Death Registry that is somewhat in some disarray at the moment, but there are systems at the national level. Snowbirds go to Florida. If you die in Florida, it's much more complicated to find that out. Then we check with the courts because, of course, if you've been convicted of a felony and you've not had your civil rights restored, this is flagged in your file. We also check with the courts to see if somebody has lost their right to vote because a guardianship has been stated by a judge that this person has lost their right to vote. We also are using the national change of address system of the Postal Service to check on address changes. People move very, very, very often. This past period in particular with the economy as it is, young people of course, but just kind of everybody. So that's another one of the systems that we use, that we keep up, that we keep current on. So there's a number of these systems that we use, and if this registration gets through those, then we want to keep it current. One of the main tools we use is the National Change of Address because that's a place where we can automatically create an update. If we use their systems, merge them, it appears that you've moved, we will send you a postcard that says, as a service to you, we've updated your voter registration, but if that's not what you wanted or if there's some change of that, so that's one system. But all of that information about changing actually has to go to the county level because in our system of elections, the county owns a list. The county chief election officer, often called the county auditor, but not everywhere, is the only person. Our office can't make any changes on any voter list except there is a required federal purging. If somebody has not voted for several cycles for over a four-year period, their registration is put into inactive, and we are allowed to do that. Otherwise, it is basically a note sent down electronically to a county election official saying, hey, we think this address should be updated in this way. Can you please check that out? And if that's true, please take that action.
Sounds very complicated to me.
It's a great system.
I have a question from our audience. If we do electronic voting, how can you tell if this the signature of the person who is voting? When I do credit card signing, my signature doesn't look anything like it usually does.
I don't hear anyone proposing electronic voting. It's against the law in the state, and I don't hear anyone proposing it at all.
Okay, thank you. Let's move on to online voter registration, which has been authorized in 18 states, and the first one was Arizona in 2002. Last October, online voter registration was implemented in Minnesota without enabling legislation.
And just a moment.
Well, just a minute.
That's not a true statement. So
oh, okay.
I don't know where that came from.
But this has resulted in a lawsuit by a group of Republican lawmakers and two interest groups who call these actions illegal. So the question is, what is the status of online voter registration in Minnesota?
Well, I would say one status is that many individuals, including yourself or whomever wrote the question, have seen part of the information, but perhaps not the other part. In the year 2000, the Minnesota legislature mandated that all electronic signatures be accepted by the courts as equal to what we used to call wet signatures, required the courts to accept that, and authorized all agency heads in state government to implement all transactions electronic as they chose to do so. 2000, it passed unanimously. We've implemented, I think, 64 online tools in our office under that mandate, and we find them great. Most of them are in business services, a number of them are in elections. This is just the next one that we've done. So it's a mischaracterization, it's not very helpful, that kind of characterization. But why would people want to keep paper voter registration and oppose electronic? I can say that one reason that I've been told is that when you take a paper registration, let's say you're at a bus stop, you're at the state fair, you're at the shopping mall, somebody says, have you changed your name? Have you moved? Would you like to update your registration? You fill it out and give it to them. They can take that, and they do take that and Xerox it, and your name, your phone number, your email, your last four of your social or your driver's license is now in the possession of a candidate, a political party, or some company they've hired from Las Vegas and Florida. This is common practice. It has been allowed to go on because the legislature created a loophole. So having people say, no, we must have paper voter registrations, the only serious argument that I see for that is that they want to continue harvesting the private personal information of people who turn in paper voter registration. This is why Arizona, Utah, Indiana, Nebraska, all the states who started and very quickly imposed new systems to get rid of the paper registration is because this harvesting of people's personal data is objectionable to almost anyone who thinks about it. So when somebody says, no, we want paper, it's probably because they want to harvest the personal information of people, and we've got to stop that. Now, the fact is, it's extremely expensive. The Arizona experience, and it's been 10 years in Arizona, 83 cents on a paper, 3 cents on electronics. 80 cents saving on 600,000 on a same-day register, we're talking about $500,000. So somebody wants to spend another $500,000 of local government money so they can keep harvesting the personal data off of people, off paper voter registration lists. This is why all of these, particularly the western states, Utah and Kansas, Nebraska, they've said, are you kidding me? And the corruption that goes on with these, have these companies from Florida and Nevada taking these voter registration forms and taking that information and turning it into fundraising appeals and all kinds of things. This is the reason why other states have been very aggressive. I think that Arizona is something at about 75 or 80% now of their voter registration. It's because they've had 10 years or maybe 11 years now are electronic. And of course, when you have somebody entering their data at home behind the firewall, they're protected. People can't steal their data unless they're sophisticated. And there are sophisticated people stealing our data for sure. But more importantly, they're typically putting in the proper spelling, the proper address, and again, we'll go back to how do you keep a list cleaned up? How do you note that someone has been convicted of a felony if, you know, Anderson with an O or Anderson with an E? I mean, these kinds of things that come when you have accurate voter registration lists and data rolls are demonstrable improvements on election integrity. So, the movement towards more online transactions authorized in 2000 was a nudge by the legislature to agencies of all kinds to get going, get busy, clean up these lists, make transactions things people can do at home. And when it comes to our office, Office of Secretary of State, we've taken this seriously and we have over 60 of our transactions now online and people love them. People write us love letters about how great these are. People stop me on the street and say, I don't know what they're talking about at the legislature, but we use your system. And so for us, it's clear that the legislature's decision in 2000, which was to say, get going, you decide when, where, and how, but get going, is the preferable way for the legislature to nudge. But when the legislature says, you have this system by this date, and we'll give you a third of the money you need, and so on and so forth, then it is a recipe for the kind of disasters that we've been seeing in the newspapers. So our office takes this business of creating something online very seriously. It has to be tested and retested, and we hire outside people to try to hack it. I mean, you know, we're not carrying people's heavy data, but we are important sources of data, and we protect it, and we've been protecting it for 30 years. But folks who want to keep paper voter registration so that somebody can harvest the personal data, I want to know why.
I have another question from the audience. With the online registrations, will the online registrations make more work for election workers?
Well, so an online voter registration in the states that we have seen, so there's 20-some states now, and, you know, they're largely Western, but they're not only Western, like Indiana and Georgia. But in places where there is, you know, when our election workers think about the work they have to do, online voter registration will give you a cleaner list, so that's one big plus. But it also will reduce the number of election day registrations, because when somebody is, you know, let's say they've moved or their name has changed or something, and they're thinking, oh, I'm just going to change it down when I vote, is a different decision than, oh, I can go online, I can see where my polling place is, I can see where my, you know, sample ballot is and all of that, and I can double check my registration and see if it's current, and if not, I can click a button and I can find out and change it. So my impression is that if we follow the pattern that we've seen in the other states, there will be a reduction in election day registration, which is a really, really good thing. It's just a big job. We have to have special judges, you stand in line. And when we talk about the lines, of course, we're talking about lines to vote, but more importantly, in some instances, the lines to do the registration. Now, for folks who just moved, just turned 18, just come to our state, they need election day registration. That's how we do things. And in a way, that's why election day registration is so important. But for the folks who just moved and they could just fix it online and just walk right in, that's what we should, you know, that's what we should be doing. So I think anything that makes the system cleaner and more accurate, you know, that's just going to be better. But mostly, it's going to save money to taxpayers and local governments, because that's where the big costs are. 83 cents versus 3 cents. The 600,000 I mentioned, you know, some years, you know, it'll be a million total just because the number of people moving and young people and that kind of thing. So we're having significant potential savings, and those savings all accrue to the county government. And so when the decisions are made at the state level and they're not thinking about somebody else's money, it might take a little bit of nudging to get them to say, oh, you know, that's a savings for the county government or the city government. Let's make sure that happens.
There's a question from the audience. What is the status of the online registration lawsuit?
It's a lawsuit.
You want to expand on that?
I'm not inside the judge's brain or know when, where, or how he'll make a judgment. So I don't comment ever on lawsuits.
Let's move on to the next question, which is on overcoming barriers to voting and improving voter turnout. The largest group of citizens who are not eligible to vote in Minnesota are those who have been convicted of a felony and have not completed their sentence. So do you favor restoration of voting rights for felons who are on probation or parole? Why or why not?
Well, I'm not sure that is the largest group of people who are disenfranchised, but anyhow, it's a very important subject because it's a clear change in the way that people feel incorporated into the community, and the scientific research is pretty clear when people become re-enfranchised and are reintegrated through voting and other civic activities, there's a reduction in recidivism. So any reduction of recidivism is a big cost savings, but it's just better for society. I favor the North Dakota system, and in fact, the Felon Task Force, the Reenfranchisement Task Force that took place 2 years ago, our recommendation had a lot of explanation about why the North Dakota system is an excellent system. Their system is if you're in prison, which is prison is where you are sent on some circumstances on felonies, you cannot vote, and if you're out of prison, you can. The advantages are obvious in one level. It's a very clean system, and it means that an election judge doesn't have to do a lot of this and that and this and that. It's also, for the individual, it's a very clean system. I'm in, I'm out, that sort of thing. But it has that advantage of what the scientific research says to us, which is when somebody's out, you want them getting re-engaged and re-involved in the system. And I hadn't really thought about this much, but on Election Day 2008, a young man who had gone to prison at a young age, had a young girlfriend, his picture was blasted all over the state because on Election Day of 2008, he had called his probation officer and had left him, unfortunately, a message that said, "Hey, I'm getting my act together, I'm being a good citizen, I'm a very strong supporter of Senator McCain and Senator Coleman, and I'm going to vote." And he was just proud as can be, because he had been kind of messed up his life, and he was getting his life back together, and he had a job, and all that. So he went over and voted, and his probation officer got the message and called him and said, "No, don't vote, you can't vote, that's another felony, you'll go back to prison." And the young man freaked out. He said, "What do you mean go back to prison? I wasn't trying to do anything wrong, I was trying to be a good citizen." And of course it was a mess. It was blasted all over the state. You know, his whole story with the young girlfriend, everything, I mean, it, you know, and for the county, it was a whole bunch of money. They had to, you know, hire investigators, they had to prep this whole thing, and then they eventually reduced the charge. It was a gross misdemeanor, so it was not another felony, and then he had 30 days to work out. So his whole life got turned upside down and shaken beyond belief because he had not been told, and this became clear, he had not been told, and the judge was furious about this. The judge said publicly, the legislature must make sure these young people know that there's a message. The legislature passed overwhelming bipartisan support a bill requiring the judges to inform and for the corrections officials to inform, and that bill got vetoed. And then the next year, when it came to the committee chairman would not hear the bill. And in this last session, when it came to the conference committee, it got stopped. So when people have a solution to our current problem, our current situation that would make a difference, and it's vetoed or blocked, it makes me worry that there's a desire to have big headlines and people in trouble. This young man, this strong McCain-Coleman supporter, stories blasted over the paper, implied to some people that there were big problems in our voting system, and then that was used to justify other kinds of measures. So when a solution to the problem of not informing these young people that they've lost the right to vote and they can't vote until it's restored, vetoed, blocked, refused, it makes me nervous that we're not going to ever get to a real solution because there's a desire to keep the problem so that the problem can be used as an excuse for some other mechanisms for vote suppression in some other way. So I'm hopeful that this North Dakota system, that's what we often call, that there'll be more conversation about it, because frankly, even the cost of the county, for the county and all this process and procedures, we have other things that we need to be doing. And when we look at other states, they're moving in the direction of acknowledging the scientific research and saying, hey, we need to get these people reintegrated into society, not continue this. Minnesota has a reputation for not incarcerating a lot of people, but using very long probation sentencing, very, very long probation periods. And that creates an even more difficult situation because there's almost no connection between probation officials and community corrections and an individual over time. So we actually have, in a way, a kind of more complicated problem, and we need to be finding a solution. I don't hear much discussion about it right at the moment, but it does come up.
Thank you. Let's move on to the topic of early voting. Presently, Minnesota does not allow early voting, where a voter can go to an election office and vote a ballot just like they would at a poll site. But 32 states do allow for early voting. So what are the main arguments for and against implementing early voting in Minnesota?
So we have early voting in Minnesota. 46 days before the election, you can go into your city clerk's office or you can get your absentee ballot and vote. So it's not true that we don't have early voting. We don't have early processing. That means the county clerks and the city clerks have got to spend a lot of time and money fooling around with all the paperwork. So we have early voting. We don't have early processing. Why don't we have early processing? I can't speak for that. I have no idea. But we have early voting, and people make use of it. You go to Clay County, 46 days before, those RVs are lined up. They're turned on. They go in. They vote. They're off to Florida. We have good early voting systems in Minnesota, and people make use of them. Next year, this year that we're in now, about the middle of the year, when we get past the possibility of any special election, we'll also have no excuse absentee voting for everybody. And we'll have the ability to order those online. And if we follow the pattern of other states, people will say, you know, I can have my ballot and I can use the internet and research these judges and these soil and water district things and these matters. And we're gonna see an increase in early voting and voting by mail on a steady and probably relatively rapid rate of speed. People want early voting. People have been using early voting. So will we get early processing of the vote so that our county and city budgets won't be so stretched through the process? I don't know.
So if early voting were implemented, when would the results of the early voting be made public?
Well, I don't know. We have early voting and we make the results public after the close of the election.
So with the implementation of online voter registration and no excuse absentee voting, Minnesota has taken steps to modernize our election system and also make voting more accessible to the public. What other methods could we use to modernize our system and also increase voter participation?
I think they're probably two different questions. Increasing participation, typically, you know, in our best years, there's 1 million people not voting. That's in the best years. So we're the best voting state in the nation, and in our best years, 1 million people don't vote. So that's like a whole evening's discussion. But how the modernization can happen, for instance, right now every young man is registered for the draft at 18. Perhaps someday every young woman will also be. It's an automatic system. It can just be converted into a voter registration like that. Would it increase turnout? Possibly, if people are on the list and the candidates are out knocking on doors and sending literature and calling, and you know, that sort of thing. But that's a marrying of getting people on a list and candidate expenditure or candidate participation. Other organizations too, but let's be frank, it's the big spending campaigns that sort of drive some of these issues. I personally think that there's other things that we can do to modernize our system that help us be kind of able to more easily follow when somebody moves. Like when somebody goes to another state, there are more things that we could do to let the other state know that an eligible voter in our state has moved to that state. And so 9 or 10 states have a new system. They call it ERIC, and I don't know what the letters stand for, but we are looking at participating, that has a lot of sort of cross referencing and cross, you know, to kind of clean up the system. However, the three things that we notice that have to do with actual voter turnout, because when we are at 75%, 76% in a good year, there are some parts of the state that are 90-some percent, so there must be some part of the state at the 60%. So an average is great. I'm very happy that we're the top voting state in the nation, but I'm aware that that's a disparity of a certain kind. Some is the necessity, especially of young people, to just give them information about our system, or people who've moved here. People have so many different experiences around the country or wherever they're from that, so they're just an information thing. League of Women Voters is very, very active in letting people know, and that includes being at immigrant naturalization ceremonies and greeting people in the community, so that's one thing. But there's really a second thing that's related but different, and that's actually welcoming people. Young people in particular are shy. Now, this may not feel like it around the house, but the notion of doing something you haven't done, or maybe looking foolish, or maybe not knowing, or whatever, this is a serious matter. And of course, we don't stay number one in voting if our young people don't vote. I mean, you know, I mean, it's, we'll all keep voting, and then we'll die, and then we'll be, you know, like the other, you know, Hawaii or something. But I know from many instances of helping young people use the machines that when they do it and they stick it in, then they go to their friends, well, that wasn't so hard. Oh no, it's kind of cool. And so we've been urging schools, bring in the voting equipment for the high school homecoming queen and vote. Now, not every kid is in high school. When kids turn 16, you know, in my neighborhood, half of them are out of school. So high school isn't the beginning and end of this, but we do need ways to welcome people. That also means getting more young people in the polling place as poll worker trainees and as poll workers. If young people go in and, well, you know, we're all kind of, you know, but you know, so that's the thing. But the third part is a portion of our neighbors, perhaps some of us in the room, have had an experience in life that says, I don't need to vote, I don't want to vote, why waste my time voting? And it can be one vote doesn't matter or something, but it also can be, oh, I worked hard for so-and-so and then they compromised or they sold out or I was disappointed or, you know, something is in the heart. And we began asking the question in public forums, you know, like I was up at Red Lake, which is up near the Canadian border, Red Lake Indian Reservation, fairly isolated area. And I asked the audience, there was a big public forum, and I asked the audience, hey, you guys are voting in the 90% range up here. You know, that's very good. You know, how do you do it? Can I share that with other people? And it got dead silent. And of course, you don't like dead silent, you know, it goes on for hours, it seems like. But probably 5 or 10 seconds after the dead silent, a young woman stood up in the back, and she pointed at me, and she said, when you drove in tonight to Red Lake, to the town hall, that you drove by the big, giant VFW hall, Veteran Foreign Wars Hall. She said, inside of that hall is a long, long list of all the braves that have given their lives for this country. And she pointed to the ground, she said, we love this beautiful place, we are very patriotic, and we vote. And she silently sat down, and the whole room nodded just like this, and that was kind of it. So I took that in. I said, well, now that's an explanation for them. Like, why do they vote in 90%, 92%, 93%? And very soon after that, I was in Hermantown, which, you know, maybe you know, it's up near Duluth. I'm at a Rotary luncheon, round table, rubber chicken, the whole thing. I'm sitting next to the president of the chamber, who's a publisher, and I say, hey, you know, you guys up here, you vote in the 90% range. Very unusual. No city is like Duluth. They vote in the 90% range. In the nation, nobody's like that. And he didn't blink. He looked at me and he said, we're very patriotic and we take care of the things that we love, and that includes voting. Just like that. And I realized that this president of the chamber at the Rotary and this young Native American woman had said more or less the same thing, which is, we love this place, but we're not the kind of people to say, oh, we love America, we love Minnesota. When we love something, we take care of it. And taking care of this place that we love includes voting. So if those sorts of values, we can continue to reinforce those values, then the hardening of the heart that takes place when you're disappointed politically or something like that, if you can be reminded of something that connects you to that, this can help overcome some of that cynicism. And it's one of the reasons we developed our Vote in Honor for Veteran program, because we're able to say, and you know, when I'm at the state fair, there's 1,000 people an hour going by, and no, I don't vote, I don't, you know. But if you get them, say, oh, well, what about our Vote in Honor for Veteran program? And you get them talking about their great, great, great grandfather in the Civil War, or their dad who was in the Second World War, or their daughter who's in Kuwait. And pretty soon you can get them into a conversation about something bigger. And there's a possibility of connecting to a value that says, well, you really love this, but oh yeah, you know, well, we gotta take care of it, yeah, you know, well, you gotta get out and vote. And I had this great experience where a woman came by in one of those little motorized carts, and I kind of harassed people. I said, you vote, you know, blah, blah, blah. She said, I always vote. She just drove by it. And I, you know, pay attention. And then pretty soon I realized everybody was getting out of the way and she was backing that thing up. I had no idea how to reverse. And she said, that wasn't totally true. I said, what? She said, a few years ago, I didn't vote. And my brother-in-law, and I hate my brother-in-law, he said, if you don't vote, you can't bitch. I said, I hate it, but he was right. And but I've voted ever since. And so I kind of feel like in our society, if we transmit the notion that if we care about something, we take care of it, we don't just say it, then taking care of it has to include a number of things, being active in the community, contributing, whether it's at church or whatever it might be, whatever you're doing, and voting has to be part of taking care of something we love. If we can transmit those values, you know, we're at 75%, can we push it up to 80? We're at 80%, can we push it up from that? But mostly, we're in a conversation with each other about taking care of this place. Voting is one thing. There's lots of other things to do.
Thank you. Let's talk about same-day registration. The League of Women Voters of Minnesota would like to improve Election Day registration in a manner that is reasonable and that we feel is definitely needed. Do you support allowing additional documents to prove identity and address?
Yes, and we've proposed new rules and regulations that are under consideration. I also am in favor of reducing dramatically Election Day registration. If you move and stand in line at the post office and turn in your form, you shouldn't have to stand in line again. It should be automatically updated if we can. You know, if we have a way to send a notice out to people saying, hey, yeah, take a minute, check your registration. If it's not up to date, boom, go fix it. I think there's lots of things that we can do to dramatically reduce Election Day registration, which will reduce lines, it'll speed things up, people's experience will be better, local election officials will have less work to do afterwards, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And whether this is good or not depends on your point of view, candidates will have cleaner, more complete, more accurate lists to work from, so less of those wasted calls and you know, more opportunity to get legitimately important literature out to people.
I'd like to know about how many people who register on same day are deemed ineligible later. This was a question from the audience who said, in 2008, about 10% of the Minnesota population registered on election day, with about 10%, actually 9.6%, could not be confirmed as eligible. Do you know what the numbers truly are for who is not eligible, who actually does register on election day?
Well, it would be a county, Sukanashra County, but it's a really tiny number.
So it's not significant.
Well, I don't know what significant is. Like, for example, how many people have died after they've dropped off their ballot, and then what's that situation? You know, it's complicated if somebody has died. And so you have a lot of little weirdnesses in elections, and you do the best you can. But often it takes 5 or 6 months for people to do their typing for all their same day registrations. And there's plenty of people that move 2 or 3 times in a year. Students, you know, they're moving each quarter and stuff like that. So the system, why we use 9 different connections on this is because we have a lot of things that we have to do to verify people. So I think there's a kind of underlying thing, which is, oh, you know, there were billboards, Minnesota number one in election fraud in the nation. That's an attempt to create an impression to then create support for vote suppression to keep some people from voting. But it certainly doesn't reflect who we are as a state. So wait a minute here. And trash talking the state, like people will come in and say, oh, we're the worst state in the nation for small business, you know. And they'll show me an article that says Minnesota created only 6,000 new businesses. I registered the businesses. I registered 67,000, you know. So I'm like, where does this information come from to trash talk about our state? can we do to try to straighten out the record? Well, if somebody's intention is something else, they paint a picture here to accomplish something over here, it's a complicated and lifelong. The price of liberty, vigilance, lifelong vigilance.
So is there voter fraud in Minnesota?
Well, down in Coates, remember Coates? The strip club owner registered almost 100 people at the strip club to try to get the city council overturned. He got caught. Our first governor's election, if you were a half-breed, as they said in the law, in the Constitution, and you wore pants, you could vote. And so the candidate that had a pair of pants and handed it down, and people then went around, stole the very first election in the state of Minnesota. Election fraud has occurred in our state. So it happens. It's something we're always, always, always paying attention to. But it's become something of a excuse for trying to keep, I think the proposal that was on the constitutional amendment thing would have kept about 900,000 people from either voting or made it really hard to vote. So I think the real issue is, why are those million people not voting? That million people in the highest voting state in the nation, in our best year, in a little tiny state, a million people didn't vote. That's a question. It's a democracy challenge. That's a crisis in our democracy, and we're at the top of the pack. Those are some issues that I think really need some pretty serious work. That young man up in Warroad, that McCain-Coleman supporter who wasn't told he couldn't vote and then got another felony charge on them, was that voter fraud? No. Was it a crime what happened to that young man? I think so.
Here's another question from the audience. As the Secretary of State, do you have the duty and authority to investigate voter eligibility?
We run 9 tests. Duty and authority. We have a strong desire for the cleanest list possible, and we have to get authority to run those different tests. So, you know, to use the change of address form or Department of Public Safety or the courts. And so we've had to get kind of authorization to do those. So those would have come through law and then through rules.
Let's move on to ranked choice voting, which has been used in the city of Minneapolis since 2009. As you know, the results of the November city elections took days to be determined. So what are the pros and cons of ranked choice voting, and what do you think is the future of it in Minnesota?
Well, I don't really, it's not for me to talk about the pros and cons of ranked choice voting. I ran a couple recounts. We didn't get an outcome of a Senate race for 9 months, you know, so like, I mean, I just think it's silly that this conversation. I have to say, for me personally, I love walking into my polling place and not having to pick one. You know what I mean? It fits my personality. I love being able to rank my people. I love it. So that's me. And that's in my Greek church where I vote. So I'm really not here to, you know, kind of review this. It's a local government choice, and local governments have different procedures by the way in which it gets decided. And in Minneapolis, we voted on it overwhelmingly. We've used it, and people love it. And I'll just speak for me. I love being able to rank my people.
So what are your thoughts about other cities using this method?
Up to them.
That was fast. Voters this November will elect a senator, all of our U.S. representatives, as well as governor, and all the constitutional offices. Historically, voter turnout is less in a non-presidential year. How can we reverse that trend?
Well, there's the big factors, which is in Senate races and in presidential races, a lot of money gets spent working up and alerting and informing and mobilizing voters. So you have really low governor and constitutional officer years when you have no Senate and you have no U.S. Senate. I mean, those are the lowest years by far. And then you have the high years, the president, Senate, et cetera. This one will be a little bit in the middle. There are no state Senate races, but there are House races everywhere. There is a Senate race. So there is the one of the big spending races. And there's a governor's race that's not a big spending race, but it's important. I mean, it's in the newspapers. And so, you know, so this one will be kind of medium-low, but not low-low, but certainly not what we want. So the bottom line question is the one that I have tried to ask in forums around the state is, what are the, because I've really stopped operating in my life on averages. We have a great school system, we have great infrastructure, we have great healthcare, but we have a bridge go down. Some people don't have any healthcare in our schools, they can be better, right? So when I think that we have we're the highest voting state in the nation this year, last year, next year, whatever, it's an average. And some people are voting in the 90%, and that's good. That's what we want. And some people are voting in the 60s. That's a big disparity. So how do we tackle that disparity? Some of the information can come from seeing what it is in the areas that are in the 90%, what's in that cultural and other thing. And then some of it is looking at the real barriers. My own experience is that the society itself has quite a few barriers for younger people. So for example, if you're younger, you're more likely to be in the military. In the military, there are a lot of barriers to being able to vote, all kinds. If you're younger, you're perhaps less likely to have your own transportation, and so getting the bus and doing certain things at certain times of the day is a difficult problem. Or you're moving, and so literature and door knocking things isn't keeping up with you as much. Or you're working two or three jobs and you are just really stretched, or you haven't built the thing. So I sort of feel like there is one element of this, which is examining the extra barriers to people who do want to be active, and then what can we do about the barriers. The two groups that have in my experience, the greatest difficulty, people in the military and people with disabilities. By far, this is the most difficult. And in both instances, there are actual barriers, in some cases real barriers, but tackling those low voting parts of our population, we have a disability task force. One of the things they bring up every time is that transportation is a really big issue. And so trying to figure out some of these other questions. States that have gone to no excuse absentee, states that have gone to some other systems that encourage mail balloting, have inside of those systems some things that help with a few of those. But I kind of, my kind of personal philosophy is that we need to tackle every single situation. And for instance, communicating to parents and to people in churches, elections coming up in November, is one of your kids or a neighbor or a friend or a coworker, are they out of the country? Are they on a missionary trip? Are they in school someplace? Are they traveling? Are they in the military service? And they need to be getting all their things in order. And so it's sort of encouraging all of us to be thinking that we are ambassadors for voting and thinking about those in our circles, our church or home or whatever circles, and then saying, hey, are you registered? You might not be here on that day. Are you registered there? So there's a kind of a thought process that makes everybody, because if we're voting in the 50 to 75% range, and higher, that means that if each of us is thinking consciously about that one other person in our life who might not, maybe for whatever reason, and we reach out to them, then we have some mechanisms for raising it up. I had a year I thought we could get up to 80, and we got up to 76%, and I felt great. We were 6% ahead of Wisconsin, who's the second state, but we don't need to talk about that. But the guy in Iowa who's running for Secretary of State made up a t-shirt that says, "I'm Brad Anderson, I'm not going to sleep at night until we're ahead of Minnesota in voting." Yes, he did. So I think, all right, a little competition. Let's take it on.
All right, now we have some questions from the audience. What is your position on voter ID? And do you agree or disagree with the idea that it alienates minorities and older voters? Please explain your position.
I don't know if it alienates people, but many older people could never get a government-issued photo ID, and in our state, this is a recurrent annual problem. But I think that the problem is the million people not voting, and this would add to the number of people who could not vote, so it's not something that I support.
Let me see if I can read this one. When same-day registrations are found to be invalid, the votes by these invalid voters have already been counted and cannot be recalled. So how do you prevent this situation?
Well, it's like the young man up in War Road who voted for Coleman and McCain and was fell and not yet off. His vote was in, and that's what it was. So you take his word for it, and to subtract one? No, of course not, you know. So you have situations where things happen, and really nothing can be done. But this is not, you know, not a kind of problem that is, it's a problem that's put on a billboard that says, well, it's all a bunch of voting fraud. And you start to say, what? And they say, wait a minute. And you say, oh, you mean that guy up in War Road? That Coleman Frankenberg? That Coleman McCainberg? No, that's not what I'm talking about. Well, pretty soon you say, well, what are you talking about here? And so things happen that are in the anomaly situation of human beings, like the young man who wasn't told he couldn't vote and voted, you know, there's not a specific thing that can be done about it, but it's, you do everything you can. And in that instance, the judge said, hey, legislature, pass a law required that these young people are told. Legislature did it on a broad bipartisan basis, and it got vetoed. So is the problem the young man, or is the problem the veto? And why was it vetoed?
So is there anything preventing people from informing people that have lost the right to vote or other rights from what their current abilities are?
Well, I'm not sure who are the what's in this, but there was a law passed and...
That's mine.
Yeah.
So just regarding the situation that you brought up, mm-hmm. You said nobody told him that he couldn't vote.
Right.
And you wanted a bill to
require
it. Mm-hmm. Is there anything preventing anyone from telling him? Because I don't mm-hmm. understand why mm-hmm. someone would have to be required to tell him. What's stopping anyone from telling him now?
Well, he would have to have thought through the process. So, for example, when a judge has this list of 10 things that they're signing, you can't have contact with the person you attacked or you beat up or whatever. You can't have a gun, da-da-da. There would be on the list, you can't vote. So you got to put it on the list. So some counties, Ramsey County, has been very good about trying to find people and to inform them because it costs them a ton of money to screw around with this, which is why North Dakota laughs at us. You know, they say, what are you guys doing over there? It's wasting all that money. So Ramsey County did a very good effort, I think, but putting it into law that these notifications are necessary also then gives you the proof that you need. Like if you have this in a list on a form, so you got to pass a law and a rule for the form, and then it's signed, then that's evidence in court that makes it very easy to then get a prosecution. So there's reasons why the judge said to the legislature, pass this law. There's a reason why it got broad support, and there's a reason why our task force recommended it, and you know, I'm hopeful that someday it'll happen. But you know, I'm not here to speak for the correction system or the penal system. It just says, I don't work for them. I just need them to let people know, especially young people, hey, you can't vote. That kind of thing. You can't vote.
Here's another question. Where is the money coming from to pay for online voter registration, and how much will it cost?
Well, it'll save 80 cents per registration, so it'll save about a half $1 million. So I'm not sure.
I'm assuming there's implementation costs.
Yeah, I think the programming was about $30,000, and there have been 5,000 people or so have used it. So, you know, the savings of a half a million for a $30,000 investment, not bad.
Does this come from your budget?
Yeah, and federal money. There's federal money and there's state money.
Okay.
Yeah, the savings go to the counties. That's what's great. You know, I mean, that's the thing. You know, people say, oh, it costs, it does, blah, blah, blah. Well, who does it cost and who gets the savings? And the savings, in this case, go to the cities and counties, and that's a really good thing.
I'm going to try to read this one. Are you planning on implementing as-is or connect problems first, such as military ID not recognized? Who wrote this question? I'm really having a hard time reading it.
Well, let me just say something.
I think there's been great progress in the past decade, I think, but especially in the past 5 or 6 years in getting more standardization in how election judges are trained and how the poll workers are trained. And, you know, so the current rules that are under consideration right now do expand and sort of make for the national list. But most military IDs now are pretty standardized. And I haven't heard much, you know, I haven't heard election judges saying, oh, we can't tell on military. But when you're trying to make a decision and you're in the military about where will you be and do you want to be voting by Fort Bragg because you're going to be assigned there, or do you want to be voting back in Stillwater because that's where you're from and you're going back to, and you know, you have to make a bunch of decisions. Once you make those decisions, then you have to act on them, and sometimes as you act on them, the rules are different in North Carolina than they are here. And so I do know that people get caught. Or I had a truck driver call me on election day. He had driven to Chicago to load. He expected a backhaul, and the backhaul wasn't ready. And he didn't want to drive back empty because it was bad economic time. That was hard enough. But he also didn't want to not vote. And so it was a very bad situation. Was there a mechanism where we could have helped work this out? Actually, if he had been across the border in another country, there are different rules for overseas voters. Right? But in this case, he had to drive back without a load, and this was an economic burden. So there are just things that happen in the course of elections, you know, whether it's somebody dying or, you know, whatever. They're just things that happen in lives, and you do your best. And I swear, the 30,000 people who volunteer each time, and many of you here are in that category, to be our election judge or poll workers, are saints and are hardworking, devoted public servants. And those 30,000 people, half Republican, half Democrat, really do make our system work. And they have to confront all kinds of things in the course of a day. And as we age, and as more of our babies who are born with Down syndromes and on the autism spectrum become 18, it will be more challenging for our election judges to be put in positions of having to make decisions that seem in some ways kind of arbitrary. And I predict that we will have work to do in trying to make sure that we continue to make sure that our election judges feel empowered and also are clear about the rules and about what's going on. And they are going to continue to be human beings, and we have to understand that and kind of take that into consideration.
What safety measures do you plan on having for security with online registration?
Well, you know, for 30 years we've had online registration from DBS and stuff, so there's nothing new here, and we've done a pretty good job. But we also don't talk about our security measures in public. I mean, that would be a very dumb thing to do.
All right, here's a question about a specific statute. Why wasn't Minnesota statute 201.061 passed through the legislature to allow the great idea of online registration?
I don't know. I'm not in the legislature.
Someone wants to know, where is the form for manual registration? It's not online.
It's online in maybe 9 languages.
Where specifically?
That is simply not true. Okay, if you click the form, it does not come up. The manual form does not.
There could be a problem with the machine, but should we follow it up? I mean, there are 9 languages of online voter registration, but you got to print them down.
When you click the online form, this is what you get, right here.
Well.
Okay. Another form of Obamacare, I'm sure, but this is what you get, right here.
Well, would you like a form delivered to your house tonight?
No, I'm registered.
Fabulous. Thank you. Glad that you're registered. I'm sure that every computer has a slightly different approach. So when things go online, which is one of the reasons why there's those forms
in every public building, in every post office, and in all the, you know, driver's license places and everything everybody's at. But they're online on our thing in a bunch of different languages, and who knows the particular instance. But we could print some out tonight if anyone wants. But you can also just go register online, which is means that you don't have to turn over your private data to somebody, and they don't have to read your handwriting.
Second part of the same question. Why are you collecting email? The confidentiality notice doesn't have treatment of email policy. Is this email when you register online?
Yeah, it's the confidentiality statement right here.
Well, if people are registering online, they're using email, and they get email notices. So you don't have to put your email down if you don't want to.
Yeah, it's a required field.
For online. Yeah, for online. Well,
which is the only way you can register right now.
Somebody dropped off a big pile of paper registration to me today, so I know that that's not the only way to register.
And this is his third question. The confidentiality notice says that law enforcement has access to the records of the Secretary of State. Why?
I don't know.
Do you know how they use them?
No, those things have come out of the legislature. I don't know why the legislature did that. So, but you could ask the legislature. They could tell you. And you could ask law enforcement. They could tell you.
Okay, this is the last question I have, so if any of you have any other ones, start writing. Is it the role of government to encourage greater voter turnout? If yes, wouldn't you consider it a problem that government raises and collects taxes and spends some to change people's beliefs? That is, propaganda.
Vote early. No. the weekend before. Vote the weekend before that. 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 Or vote the weekend before that. In 46 days, you have many weekends if you would like to vote on the weekend. I like Tuesday, but it's a personal preference. But I like 46 days because my life's busy and most people's lives are busy. And so having that option is a good option.
All right, here's a question from a League member, obviously. How can the League of Women voters pre-register voters without paper registration forms?
There's lots of paper registration forms, so keep at it. But if you wanted to bring around iPads, and I mean, there are lots of ways to register. So the states who have online voter registration for over a decade, like Arizona and Utah and places like that, they have all kinds of systems that they use. And so, you know, it's interesting to see which comes up with the cheapest way to do it. I'm guessing that the League of Voters, other League of Women Voters, League of Conservatives, you know, that those kind of organizations that are out there are looking at what's the most effective way. But if you're in the back room in a naturalization ceremony and people are, you know, there's young men there and young women in uniform, the minute they're done with that, they're on a plane and they're to Kuwait or what, you know, they're in a hurry because they're in the military and they've got to go someplace. You want to do it as fast as you can, and you know, so you're trying to think through, well, what's my situation and what's the best way to do it.
Are you required to follow Minnesota statutes to ensure voter integrity? If so, why do you violate statute 201.061, and it's come up again, and use executive authority to implement online registration?
2000, the legislature said, you guys get every transaction that you can online, and we've done 60 some of those, 64, I think.
Any other questions?
How many days does it, when you want an absentee ballot, how many days, what's the deadline before absentee ballots are finalized? How many days before the election?
Mm-hmm. So if you turn it in on the day of the election, it happens on that after the election. They can start opening them, I think it's on Tuesday and the week before. So let's say you voted 46 days out. It would be 40 days after you dropped in your ballot.
No, how many days before the election are the ballots printed?
Printed.
The date they're printed.
They have to be mailed 46 days before the election. They have to be in the mail 46 days before the election.
Because I have a son that's in Italy, and he's very strict about voting. He's registered here, but he lives in Italy.
Yes.
Because I was wondering, because wasn't there a big stink about the military not getting their ballots?
Yeah, and in fact, this is another example. Minnesota used to have this very late primary, and people in the military could get their ballots turned around, right? Because, you know, you'd have a primary, and then if there was any kind of recount or whatever, then you couldn't get the ballot. So we passed the bill moving the date of the primary, and it got vetoed. It's like, what are you thinking? And finally, the federal government passed a law saying it must be, and the federal government actually said 45 days, which put a Saturday, so we said 46 days. But we also passed a law that said that your son and anyone in the military and those overseas can also receive it electronically, so like by fax or by facsimile or by an email, but it has to be printed and then mailed back. So now we have 46 days and you can get it essentially instantaneously, you know, if he's got a printer and a computer. And so he has nearly twice the amount of time as he had before, and the ballot can come basically like that. But if he happens to be home 46 days, you know, home for, you know, holidays or home for the state fair or whatever like that, that's in that 46 day, depending on what day they're home and stuff, but 46 days is now the requirement for mailing out or distributing, making available absentee ballot, and it's because it's what was necessary for our soldiers and others serving in the military to be able to get their ballot and get it back in. That's why we did it.
So basically, right now, there's no reason that anyone overseas could not get their ballot counted.
There have been instances when ballots have gotten lost and come 30 days late, but I think our completion rate last election was 99.1%. So we are darn close, notwithstanding that odd lost, you know, shows up in a plastic bag with a yellow thing on it. But yeah, with the electronic delivery and with 46 days, you know, we're pretty good. We need to reach out to people who were disappointed in the past because it didn't work for them and let them know that there's a new system. They can get it fast and they have 46 days. And so our office has been focusing on reaching out to people who we know were frustrated. They write us horrible letters. I tried to vote and it was too late. And we say, hey, you know, the law's changed. You know, give it a try. And, you know, we get that.
So stories like I've heard, you might throw them in the basket. They don't.
Like, here's an odd thing. So there are some ships that they're so weight sensitive they don't allow them to bring paper to print on. Well, we hadn't thought through that problem. There's something called a submarine ballot, because when the submarines would go down and you could basically just write in the party or the person name or something like that, and that ballot, what we still call a submarine ballot, tried to create a kind of a flexibility for people who were in the Navy and who were really out of touch for a long period of time. I think there's always somebody in a forward base in Afghanistan someplace where they really are, and the mail drop didn't come, you know, because they have to mail it back. You know, there are little things, but it is so much better than before, and we get fabulous letters from people who said, you know, I tried in Vietnam, I tried in Korea, blah, blah, blah. But last time I tried and it worked. And, you know, so we know that this new system, the Congress passed 45 days, we made it 46. The Pentagon suggested 90 days, which, I mean, that's a long time. But 45 looks like it has worked out pretty well. So for right now, I feel like our work is reaching out to disappointed people from before to get them to try it again. And is your son serving in Italy in an American base? Is that
he just works strong with that?
Yeah.
Not military.
No, but he's overseas serving the nation.
I think we're going to count that this is the last question. Do you plan to lobby for early voting without all of the cost of absentee paperwork, which costs the city about 8 times more than in-person voting?
Yeah, I've been arguing for early processing. I'm happy we have early voting, but I really think early processing would save us some money. Walk in, fill in your ballots, stick it in the box, you're done. I mean, that is just the least expensive, in a way, kind of the best system. You don't have anyone opening or any possibility of loss. Other states do this, and they have for a long time, and it seems to be a very good system. I put a real focus on trying to oppose unfunded mandates and also trying to find out where there are cost savings. And so electronic poll books could bring us some cost savings. In some places, early processing or having people stick them right in can achieve us cost savings. And those savings accrue to the local property tax payers. And so I think that'd be a good thing. We'll see what the legislature wants to do.
Slowly, the last question. You've said that you're not going to seek another term as Secretary of State. So what are your plans for the future?
Spend more time with my family. Decide if I want to go back and be a history teacher again or not. Pay attention a little bit more to the things that have piled up on my desk over the last 8 or 9 years and see what is in there. Read a few books and magazine articles. So you must read this. But I have a lot to do in this year. We have big elections. We have, you know, we're this business climate is up and we register businesses. You know, elections is the smallest of the things that we do in our office. So business service is the biggest by far. So I feel like I'll be super busy, and some young, courageous person will take my place, and I'll get to hand off the baton and hopefully have everything in good order. And there's some things that I'm able to do because I'm not running that are good to do in terms of putting the office in good shape. And then I'm, you know, old enough to not have to do anything that I don't want to do, and I'm young enough to do things that I do want to do, and so I'm going to take advantage of that. But I've, you know, I spent my life working on agriculture and family farm issues, and I'm sure I'll go back to making sure I'm paying attention to the strength of our rural economy as well. So so we'll see. But I got another year, and I got a lot of work to do.
Well, I thank you so much for being here this evening and for answering all our questions. We'd also like to thank the City of White Bear Lake for the use of these facilities, for the Ramsey Washington Suburban Cable Commission for taping tonight's forum, which will be rebroadcast in 12 municipalities. If you check on the gtn.org website, it'll have the list of rebroadcast dates. And on behalf of the League of Women Voters, thank you again.
Thank you very much.
It was wonderful to meet you.